tuo fa l'americano, americano, americano. Ma si nati in Italia, sienta a me non c'è sta niente fa. Tuo fa l'americano, tuo fa l'americano, tuo fa l'americano, tuo fa l'americano.
Hello, welcome to Italics, the Italian American magazine. I'm your host, Anthony Tamburri. On this edition of Italics, we encourage you to replace any stale notions of nostalgia you may still harbor for your grandparents' old country. As Consul General Francesco Maria Talo and Gianfranco Fini, President of the Italian Chamber of Deputies, both introduce you to a new vision of today's Italy, a modern industrial country, and one of the United States' strongest political and cultural allies. First on Italics, we'll go to a lecture entitled From Pizza to Ph.D., From Dante to DNA, presented by Consul General Talo at the Coccia Institute of Montclair State University in New Jersey. The lecture is an initiative undertaken by the Italian government to present an updated image of a more modern, industrial, and technologically advanced Italy to Italian Americans, who frequently long for or imagine a rural agricultural Italy, an Italy of the past. After a luncheon celebrating the event, Italics spoke with Cavaliere Joseph Coccia Jr., benefactor of the Coccia Institute for the Italian Experience in America, and with Marianne Ray, the Institute's director, with Andrea Barbaria, Italian Consul of New Jersey, and key members of the New Jersey Italian and Italian American Heritage Commission. Next on Italics, we take you to a dinner celebrating Gianfranco Fini, President of the Italian Chamber of Deputies, on his recent visit to Washington, D.C. and New York City. The event, held at the Hyatt Grand Regency in Midtown Manhattan, was sponsored by a number of Italian and Italian-American organizations and entities. Italian Ambassador to the United States, Giulio Terzi di Sant'Agata, introduced Minister Fini. Then we go to New York University for a panel discussion on why and exactly how New York simply loves Italian food and cuisine. Now let's go to the Coccia Institute at Montclair State University for Consul General Talo's lecture.
Italy is somehow everything for me. It's a country where, of course, you can find samples of all the fields of human culture. And I would like to try to tell you about my country and to tell you also how this country is changing, like all countries of the world. So let's start with the letter A. A as art. And you can see, the classic art of the Renaissance, Michelangelo Buonarroti. But also you can see a great master of the 20th century, such as Giorgio Morandi. For instance, Giorgio Morandi, and there is always a link with the United States. Morandi had a very successful exhibition last year at the Metropolitan Museum in New York. Was a huge success, and just few weeks ago, we learned that for their collection at the White House, the presidential couple choose also to have a few Morandi. Statistics says that in Italy we detain about two-thirds of all the art heritage of the world. These are UNESCO statistics, so the cultural branch of the UN, and they are really unbelievable, because it means that the treasures of art we have in Italy are much more than all the other art which are detained in all the countries of the world together. Now, letter B. Well, letter B, we go in something specific, Barolo. Maybe many of you know the name of this wine, but it's just an example. Wine and agri-food industry. We see on one hand an image of a classic cellar, canteen, on the other hand some bottles which are today estimated to be amongst the most valuable in the world. This is to say, today wines of southern Italy are considered among the best of the world. And now Italy is the number one seller of wines in the United States. Next, creativity. Well, the word creativity, C for creativity, we are going to repeat more and more. And like art, all over the centuries, we have samples of creativity. Here we have Volta, and when you see this man, and when you will see or electric appliances, you will remember now why you say volts, why you say voltage, because of an Italian man called Volta. So the basis of electricity are somehow been created by Mr. Volta. Of course, there is Leonardo on the other side of our slide, both an artist and a great engineer, a great inventor, a scientist. And then Marconi, the inventor of radio, and many other more. So you see that much of what we use every day in our life has roots in the Italian scientific culture and creativity. But of course, creativity is also people and artists like Benigni. He won Oscar Prize with his movie Life is Beautiful. And then the word immigration. This is a country of immigrants, this is very true, and these immigrants made the change of the country, making their own change. And you see Ellis Island, where most of those who arrived there during decades at the beginning of last century were Italians. And you see one product of the success of this immigration, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi. Fashion. Fashion is something intuitive. Somehow is a stereotype, is a good stereotype, but it is certainly interesting to remember that Italy is still the country of fashion. And fashion is also part of the daily life in the modern cities. The modern Little Italy could be Madison Avenue, for instance, in New York City, where you have an incredible concentration of Italian brands, one after the other. And then the letter G. G, from Galileo to Guidoni. Galileo, we all know him. It is the International Year of Astronomy, because 400 years ago, Galileo started the modern astronomy with his observation of the universe. But we have also Italian astronauts working together with American colleagues like Guidoni, and especially we have Italian technology in the space, in the International Space Station. So Italy is a great producer of space technologies. Going on, history. Of course, we are the product of history, a history which we are somehow continuing to produce to create the future of tomorrow. So Rome with his she-wolf, and then the Renaissance, which is so well known. Rome, where we could mention many Italian cities, but Rome is called Caput Mundi, is the center of the world, and a city which was born almost 3,000 years ago, which had certainly the longest surviving state in the history of humanity, with a continuity of more than 1,000 years of statehood. And here we see the Colosseum, this huge architectural work, still have the production of modern architecture in the Italian capital, like Maxi is the Museum of Architecture of the 21st century. This is the meaning of the word Maxi. X is for 21st century. Now, tools and technology, again, part of our daily life, from the telephone. You know that the telephone has been certainly invented by an Italian living in New York, Antonio Meucci. Cell phones are somehow part of the daily life of Italy. is maybe we have an exaggerated use of telephones, so that we have 147 telephones each 100 persons, including the newborn babies. And in fact, it's very easy to see people on the streets of the Italian cities walking with two telephones on both hands. The University of Bologna is considered the first university of the world. The word university in itself includes this concept of universality, of having this global approach, comprehensive approach to culture. We have now a university system which is certainly considering with admiration the American university system, which is now probably the most advanced in the world. That's why it's a great honor to be here today. And now another symbol of the Italian daily life, Vespa. On one side you can see a Vespa of the 50s or 60s. This is not me. And on the other side, you can see a Vespa of today in New York City. And that's me. And Vespa is also part of the evolution of design, of the evolution of the ability to be free to move, beating the traffic, but also beating the pollution and the gasoline price. That's why it's so popular in Italy, and that's why it's going to be more and more popular also in America.
We're trying to get the Italian-American community to work together at all levels. The state has some 250 Italian-American organizations, for instance, and we know what happens when you can, the power of getting everyone to work together. So when the Coccia Foundation and the Commission can get together and work on events like this, it's like the perfect storm for us. So.
And there were a lot of young people present. I mean, it was packed with young students.
Well, that's actually the mission and the direction of the Coccia Institute and the Coccia Foundation. That was Joe Coccia's idea. We believe that education is the future of getting people to understand that Italians and Italian Americans have made tremendous contributions not only to the state of New Jersey and to the United States of America, but to the world.
And this is what Marianne, as director of the Coccia Institute, is trying to do. Bring initiatives into the university that were never here before, and that's part of our goal. Because we're not language people, we are culture people. We preserve the culture and wish to pass it on, passing our torch. We have our main emblem, logo is a torch, and we're passing the torch to future generations. This is what we want to do.
We know we want to promote the culture with Italian Americans and those with the this kind of background, but it was definitely we make an effort to partner with other departments within the university other than our great partners in Spanish and Italian. For instance, this event, given the nature, it's political science and law.
While we respect the culture, okay, we feel that the language will come automatically if the students or adults who visit Italy and get involved with the culture, they learn more about it. They'll want to know the language.
This was a perfect event for us because Consul General Talo made a point of saying, yes, I speak with the community a lot. I really want to speak with students. And when he had prefaced his talk with this is a conversation, that's really what he wanted, because he really has part of his mission engaging young people. And that's why this was a perfect marriage of his objectives and ours.
That there are a lot of Italian companies now investing in Jersey.
Many companies which have the showroom in Manhattan and the logistic center or the headquarters in New Jersey. Just to give an example, Geox, the company which produces shoes in Italy, another important company, the Mediterranean Shipping Company, I think the second shipping company in the world, which is based in Manhattan, logistics center in New Jersey. I think to Maserati Ferrari. They have the big and famous showroom in Manhattan, but they are based also in New Jersey, where they have their headquarters.
Mm-hmm. Now we join the more than 1,300 people at this month's dinner at the Hyatt Grand Regency with Gianfranco Fini, President of Italy's Chamber of Deputies.
Quando si parla degli italiani in America, quando si parla degli italoamericani, quando si parla dei figli e dei nipoti dei nostri emigranti, quando si parla di tutti quanti voi e di ciò che voi rappresentate, alla Camera non c'è distinzione. Quando si parla dell'Italia negli Stati Uniti, si parla di tante donne e di tanti uomini come voi che rimangono, perché hanno messo le radici. Quella identità è stata costruita anche dalla fatica, dal lavoro, dal sacrificio di tante donne e di tanti uomini che venivano dalla nostra cara Italia. L'alleanza, l'amicizia tra Stati Uniti e Italia non è soltanto la storia di ieri. I soldati italiani e i soldati statunitensi sono insieme, diffondendo la nostra lingua. È un motivo di particolare soddisfazione apprendere che negli Stati Uniti cresce il desiderio di apprendere e di parlare l'italiano. Credo che le istituzioni abbiano il dovere di dare una risposta positiva a questa domanda. Abbiamo il dovere di continuare a lavorare insieme in tanti settori dell'economia, in tanti settori del mondo culturale, universitario, accademico. Oggi i cervelli italiani che vengono negli Stati Uniti rappresentano delle eccellenze e in questo personalmente trovo che vi sia una sorta di postuma e successiva gratifica per quei tanti tanti italiani che vennero qui quasi analfabeti, senza conoscere una parola d'inglese, arrivando a Ellis Island, guardati in molti casi con sospetto se non con diffidenza. Oggi gli italiani che vengono negli Stati Uniti sono ricercatori universitari, sono imprenditori, sono donne e uomini che rappresentano una punta di eccellenza. Questa sera qua la Camera dei Deputati saluta e ringrazia ognuno di voi per quello che avete fatto e per quello che fate, nella certezza che l'alleanza transatlantica non è soltanto un'alleanza di tipo militare e nemmeno un'alleanza soltanto di tipo politico. Grazie.
And now let's join Lucia Grillo at the recent panel discussion at NYU, which asked the question, why and exactly how New York simply loves Italian.
Italian food in New York, somehow it seems to have taken over. It seems to have been the origin. It seems to be in the midst of everything. But today, what we're going to talk about is how this all came to be, why New York so loves Italian.
The first Italian restaurants began appearing in the 1850s in New York, and there weren't very many of them. And you have to remember that Italian food and Italian culture was very exotic. In the 1850s, there were Italians, and they tended not to be from southern Italy. They tended to be from northern Italy. And they created standalone restaurants, and some of them were not these little checkered tablecloth kind of restaurants. They were actually quite high-end and sumptuous. I did a little homework for this, then went back to an 1882 guide to the city written in Italian, and it singled out some of the more prominent Italian restaurants, and there was no proprietor who was from farther south than Tuscany. Some of these restaurants, they tended to be clustered around Union Square, where there were lots of theaters, and therefore heavy traffic for restaurants. And one of them, Ricadonna's on Union Square, one of the greatest of its day, was described as this very elegant, grand restaurant where the cream of society would go to dine. Just in this guidebook, advertisements in the front, many of them for little boarding houses run by Italians. And you're seeing a more down-market expression of Italian food in these sorts of places, which were all over this area here. And typically, but again, northern, it tended to be northern Italians until the 1890s and after. Often, these were people who came from cities. They were not poor. They were not peasants coming from the rural areas of Italy. They had some education. They had some wherewithal. And they tended to, they would manage to get a brownstone or a townhouse, and the basement or the ground floor would be turned into a restaurant. Often the wife would do the cooking, the husband would manage the business part of it, a few relatives would be the staff, and it was offering a fixed price, often a fixed price menu for say 30 cents. If we're talking about 1880, that would be, I'll give you a typical menu, 30 cent dinner. 1885, start with soup, fish, then an entree or pasta, a roast meat, followed by coffee. If you went for the deluxe, $1.25, around about the same time, you would get seven courses with wine. These restaurants almost immediately attracted the bohemian element in New York. The Italian proprietors who'd been, you know, boarding their own countrymen in the building and thought they would be feeding their own countrymen were faced with these sort of crazy painters and deadbeat writers and journalists and all sorts of people they hadn't anticipated taking pasta out to. And that is how the food became disseminated. It became perceived as less exotic, and gradually it became what you call the default cuisine in New York. And because many of them were journalists, they would write about it. New Yorkers got to hear about it. The great wave of Southern Italian immigration came along, and that brought a whole sort of second life to Italian cuisine in New York and gave us those little tiny restaurants with the red sauce and the pasta that, you know, some of them are still around us and seem to be absolutely ancient and still run by the first people who set them up.
When I first came to the U.S. In 1998, for me it was interesting to see, to discover, for instance, Italian-American cuisine. I had no clue. The way of being together was there, the way of sharing, the wine, all that was there. I was just not familiar with the food. And I needed some cultural translation there. So I've been discovering Italian-American food, and it's different from what I'm used to. But at the same time, here in New York, now you can have Italian food the same way you would have it, you know, in a hip trattoria in Rome. Back in 98, it was still a little difficult to find everything I needed for my daily cooking. You could find it in a restaurant, but for as a private person, it was a little more complicated. Now you can really find everything.
Now, one of the reasons Italian food became so enormously successful in New York was it presented a different way of thinking and feeling about food. This guidebook I referred to, this 1880s guidebook, had a kind of warning at the beginning to Italians. It was intended for Italians visiting New York, saying, you know, your understanding of what it is to eat, I got to explain something to you about America here, that in New York they have these things called eating houses, and everybody piles into them in the noon hour, and they feed 1,000 people and about 35 minutes, and people eat their meals in less than 20 minutes. And as an Italian, you're going to find this very unsatisfying, although you should just go to one of these just to watch. But when you want to eat, here's where the Italian restaurants are, so you can eat as you understand eating to be and how it should be.
In the last couple of years, Italian food has really become food in New York. When we are at a moment in American history where we must preserve, we must understand, we must share our foodways, then it's logical that a culture, a series of groups who have preserved and have maintained for thousands of years specific foodways, be at the front of what we're thinking and what we're eating.
What is the difference between Italian cuisine and Italian food as Italian Americans usually know it?
Truly, Italian cuisine is going back to basics, getting the best produce, the best ingredients, And let's face it, Italian food is feel-good food.
People bringing real authentic good products from Italy, importing them, and just saying, you know what, we could sell that stuff here. It's expensive, but it's worth it. It's just like anything else, a good meal. You know, a diner compared to a fine restaurant, you're going to taste the difference. And that's why I try to bring these people to come and display their talents through food.
Italian-American food has the connotation that it was immigrant food that was adapted to local ingredients and local food ways and needs. And after all, the most important thing is food. Without it, we're gone. And with it, we have not only simple life, but we have great life. We have nourished life. We have interesting, engaging, passionate, beautiful, deep, and rich and delicious life.
On Italics News Briefs, we'll bring you some of the stories making news in our Italian American community.
Mamma, c'è di là l'amministratore. Affrontiamo un po' la situazione.
Senti, mi raccomando, eh?
100 euro, mamma mia, esagerato. Caro proprio, te pago io. Me la puoi tenere qua due giorni? Mia madre.
Zeitgeist Films is proud to release a new Italian language film, Mid-August Lunch or Pranzo di Ferragosto, opening March 17th at Film Forum in New York City, then in theaters nationwide. The charismatic Gianni Di Gregorio, co-writer of the smash hit Gomorrah, stars in his directorial debut, an utterly charming tale of good food, feisty ladies, and unlikely friendships during a very Roman holiday. Pranzo di Ferragosto, Italy's biggest summer holiday. For more information, visit midaugustlunch.com. More than 100 scholarships for academic year 2010 to 2011 are still available to qualified Italian-American students through the National Italian-American Foundation. The March 5th deadline fast approaches, so go online to niaf.org/scholarships for information, rules, and eligibility. Italics would like to honor Anthony Benedetto, better known as Tony Bennett, on his selection for the painting and creation of this year's official poster for the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Foundation. The year's poster depicts Louis Prima, international jazz icon, and New Orleans' hometown son. These posters sell out every year and are extremely valuable to collectors, especially artist-signed editions.
Well, that's it for this episode. Thanks for watching Italics. March is Women's History Month, and March 8th is International Women's Day. Our entire program next month is dedicated to women, and we encourage you to participate in any of the myriad events that will celebrate women's history. On the new Italics channel on livestreet.com, you can watch a replay of our symposium on Guido culture, or join us live for our next simulcast on livestream. Our web address is livestream.com/italics. And we'll be adding new and archived programming frequently, so please check the site often. Along with special one-time Italics broadcasts, we will see three new monthly programs. Italics 2.0, which will feature long-form discussions with members of our community, and Italics 2, which will be completely in Italian. We will also feature a new program featuring commentary and interviews with distinguished Professor Fred Gardafe and other exciting new projects in the coming months. So bookmark that live stream internet address and get used to monitoring the web channel and the new media. Again, thanks for watching. I'm Anthony Tamburri. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata. See you next time.